In this video, we're going to show you how to repair the LG G3 LCD flickering, dimming, and fading to black issue. So stay tuned. In the previous LG G3 repair series part 1 video, we showed you how to determine if you simply have a defective LCD screen or if you're experiencing the plague that is causing the LG G3 phones to suddenly black out and go completely dark. This has become a large problem with this model in the past few months, where the LCD is actually fine, but the phone works for a short time and then fades to black and will not come back on. Usually, if you wait a while or play with the phone, it will come back on intermittently, but not consistent at all and always ends up going dark again. So after many hours of troubleshooting and replacing numerous different components and parts, and discussing this with a few LG technicians, we've determined that this is very similar to the LG G4 boot loop problem. But for some reason on this phone, it causes the screen to go dark instead of boot looping. So we are going to remove and replace the processor IC chip. There are several complications with replacing this particular IC chip. This is a double stack processor IC installation, and it also has a lot of underfill glue. What is a double stack processor, you say? Exactly what it sounds like. There are two processor IC chips installed on top of each other. The one that is giving us the problems is the top one. Since the top processor is not attached to the motherboard, it does not cool as well as the bottom one. So from extended use over a period of time, it starts to die out from being overheated. Using the JBC hot air station and setting it to around 430 degrees Celsius at 40% airflow, start to heat the top of the processor chip. There is glue on both the bottom processor and between the top and bottom processor, where the two attach to each other. Here, we're going to clean the glue around the top processor IC chip. It's important that you try to keep as much of the flux on top of the chip rather than letting it go on the board. It won't hurt anything if the flux gets on the board, but the point is to have plenty of flux on top of the chip itself, which keeps most of the heat focused on the top chip and not the bottom one. Be sure to keep the hot air moving in a steady circular motion and slowly put very slight upward pressure just so you can feel if the chip is ready to come up. The trick here is to use just enough hot air to remove the top chip without losing any pads on the upper part of the bottom chip, but not too hot where the bottom chip moves or the underfill glue beneath the lower chip expands and causes it to break a joint. Now that we've removed the top processor chip, we're going to proceed with cleaning the top of the lower processor and getting it ready to install a new chip. One important thing that I want to point out here is to try and get the top chip off without getting the bottom chip too hot, causing the solder and the underfill glue underneath the lower chip to expand and melt. This is a very delicate cleaning process. You have to take your time and patiently clean all the underfill, and at the same time, get all the contacts clean and ready to install the new chip on top of this one. As you can see, there is a lot of underfill glue all over this chip. Where we have failed on this repair is when the top chip took too long and entirely too much heat to remove, therefore causing the bottom chip solder balls to move or the underfill glue to expand and cause the lower chip to push up just enough to cause the contacts beneath it to have a bad connection. I can tell you from experience that if you have to remove the lower processor chip and reball or replace it, your failure rate will go through the roof. It's very difficult to reinstall the lower chip and then go to install the upper chip on top of it without causing the lower joints to melt. The original factory solder melts at a higher temperature point. So if you resolder the bottom chip and then try to solder the top chip onto it, it's very likely that the lower chip solder joints will melt again during the process and cause a short. This is just a word of caution, so please take your time installing the top chip and try not to put too much heat. Hey guys, if you're enjoying this video, please be sure to give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. By the way, if you have any questions or comments, Please be sure to leave them in the comment section below, and either myself or one of our team members will be happy to respond. Instead of using just alcohol, which requires a lot of scrubbing with pressure to remove the old flux, we actually like to use the no clean liquid flux here to clean the chip. All right, so we are going to do some final preparation of the top joints and get them ready for the installation of the new processor. We apply some new fresh flux, but not too much because we're going to have to keep the top chip from moving while trying to hit it with hot air. Now carefully line up the new chip. This is a very delicate process and requires a lot of patience. So take your time and make sure it is lined up as perfectly as possible. Now put some flux on top of the new chip. And with low airflow, melt it, trying to keep most of it on top of the new chip. The flux helps to keep the heat concentrated on top of the IC chip instead of everywhere else, which will hopefully keep the lower chip from getting overheated and moving or adjusting. So go ahead and heat the top of the chip until you feel the solder balls in between the two chips are melted and making a good connection. As you can see, we don't have any solder balls popping out from underneath the lower chip, which is a very good sign. Now we're going to clean most of the flux from the board and clean the surroundings with some compressed air. We are just trying to clean it as much as possible so that we can inspect around the chip to see if the balls are properly melted and making good contact. Now let's turn the board on its side and inspect the solder balls between the two chips to make sure they are melted and making good contact. And yes, they look pretty good. Let's go ahead and put the board back together and test it. As you can see, we have success. The phone powers on and has perfect image and no fading to black. Now, I want to point out a few important things to keep the phone healthy and functional and to keep this problem from happening again. Be sure to perform a full ultrasonic cleaning to get rid of the flux in between the two chips and on the board. Remember that after ultrasonic cleaning, you may have to replace the microphones on the board, as they do usually go out from the ultrasonic cleaning process. Make sure that you install the new additional heat sinks to keep the processor from heating up again and going bad. We will have another video showing you the best heat sink method and exactly where to place it on the phone. You can find that video, the LG G3 heatsink placement, which will be video number 3 in this installment. Even though the phone may feel the same or even hotter on the outside, this procedure will keep the heat away from the processor and give it a longer lifespan, which is what we're trying to accomplish here. I'd like to thank everyone for watching and invite you to give us a thumbs up if you have found this video useful and subscribe to our channel to be notified when more videos like this one are released. Thank you for watching.